What is up, FSM? Glad to get to connect with you once again. It's week 7 of our series, New Habits. We're talking about spiritual disciplines that we can put in our life to help us connect to God. And even though we'd much rather be able to connect in person, we're excited to be able to connect online. I know we've been spending a lot of time online, and I don't know about you, but for me, I realized that being online a whole lot can get you in a little bit of trouble. You know, you might say the wrong thing, and it's out there for everybody. Or even worse, sometimes maybe you meant to send something in a private message and you accidentally made it go public. You know, that DM that was meant to go to one person, but it actually ends up on your story. Or maybe that text that was supposed to go to one friend and it goes to the whole group chat. Well, if that's you, guess what? You're not alone, because we all do it. And in fact, there was a magazine a couple years ago, Time Out New York, that did something kind of like that. They accidentally posted this kind of brutally honest job description that really wasn't meant for public consumption to their Twitter, and so everybody could see it. And it became this running joke where there's this one lady, Melissa Shipman, and apparently it was such a high-stress work environment, they were trying to find a freelance photographer to help her out because they were afraid she was going to get burnt out and quit. And as you read that, you realize, man, this is kind of a rough place to work. But the good part of that is, if someone were to go take that job, they would know exactly what they were getting into, right? Because they didn't just get kind of the fluffy, happy-go-lucky, everything's perfect here job description. They got a glimpse into what real life looked like. And to be honest, I'm afraid too many times in the church as Christians, we try to put forth this idea of being a Christian that's easy peasy, it's a cakewalk, there's nothing to it. But as we look at God's word, we realize that it actually is never promised to be easy. Jesus never promised that the Christian life would be easy. He just promised that it would be worth it. And that's what we see as we focus on these ideas of spiritual disciplines, the idea that we are working, we are disciplining ourselves to be more like Christ. And there's no other area where this is more evident except for the area of service. So this week we're talking about the spiritual discipline of service, which is really just an integral part to the Christian life. I don't know if you ever thought about it, but even as we are able to gather, and hopefully we will do so soon, but when we gather on a weekly basis on Sundays, we call that a worship service. This element, this idea of service is all throughout the Christian life, to the point that in Scripture, Christians are described as servants. The Greek word for that is doulos, and it can be translated servant. It can also be translated as slave. Now, when we think of slave, a lot of times we think of kind of the American slavery system, which was a horrific, tragic thing. In Scripture, slavery is a little bit different. But one of the things that is consistent in every area of service, servitude, whether you're a servant in a household, whether you serve as a job, or even in New Testament times when the New Testament authors would describe themselves as slaves, is that we're giving up something for the sake of another. Now, before you get offended, realize that we do see time and again where authors in the New Testament not only describe Christians as servants, they describe themselves the same way. In fact, James, who is the half-brother of Jesus, when he begins his letter, he doesn't say, I'm James, I grew up with Jesus, I'm James, I'm a leader in the church. No, he says, he calls himself James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul calls himself a servant time and again. And so what we might first be offended at, this idea that we're called servants, we realize there's a much deeper calling in our life to not only meet the call that God has placed on our own lives, but to follow the example that Jesus gives us. And so that's what we want to do tonight. Just take a few moments to open God's word together, to look at the example that Jesus sets for us as we seek to follow his lead and what it looks like to be a servant. So we'll be in the book of John, chapter 13. If you've got a Bible handy, go ahead and flip that open. You can find it on your device, or you can just read along on the screen behind me. But this is what John describes in John chapter 13, and we'll start in verse 3. And I want you to pay attention to the attitudes specifically of Jesus and of Peter. So verse 3 says, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not every one of you." He has that little end, "but not every one of you," because obviously he's talking now to all the disciples, including Judas, who's going to ultimately betray him. But as we see this exchange between Jesus and Peter, we recognize that Jesus has come to demonstrate what it looks like to serve others. And it's kind of funny when you think about it, because at first you realize Peter's offended. He's not offended because he's called a servant. He's offended because he's bought into the lie that masters don't serve. He has this rabbi, this teacher, his master, who's been leading him all this time, and now he stoops down to serve him. Not the first time, mind you. And so he's offended, but what he doesn't understand is that everybody serves something. That's the reality of our lives, is that everybody serves something. Jesus knew it as he came in obedience, serving the Father, and he demonstrated that in the way that he led his disciples, calling them to follow his example. Like we said, every act of service is giving something up. Now, it could be your time, it could be your energy, it could be your money, but it requires that we give something of our own so that we can serve someone else. So maybe it means giving up a relationship or a job, a hobby, grade, school, social media, all those different things. You know, we serve those as we sacrifice for those different things. Now, a couple weeks ago, we talked about this idea of worship and how ultimately we can worship anything. We're called to worship God only and first, but too many times we're distracted and tempted to worship things that are not God. And if worship is about an attitude, well then service is about the activity. Service is about the things that we are doing. So when we gather as Christians, we call it a service because we are gathering together to rally ourselves to pursue service of our God and our Lord and our Savior. Paul actually talks a little bit about this idea that we all serve something in Romans chapter 6. In verse 17, he puts it this way. He says, "But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves to sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching in which you were committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness." Now, what Paul is saying here, he's recognizing that we all serve something. Before we knew Jesus, every Christian was a servant, but we were serving ourselves. In fact, he says we were slaves to sin. I think we all know what that feels like. The idea that there's something that we know is not right, we know we don't want to do. Maybe it's the way we treat somebody that we love, and we do it and we hate that we do it. It's because of this idea of being enslaved to sin. And Paul says, you were once slaves to sin, you were serving sin, but now you are a servant of God. So what's the difference here? Well, we all know that everybody serves something. Saved people serve God. Now, this won't really sound that crazy to most people. I think the chances are, if you are watching this video, you probably don't have any reservations about that idea of serving God. You know, as Christians gather together, I think we would say, you know, we love God, we want to serve Him only. But what happens in our lives too many times is we're tempted to serve God and to serve other things as well. So Jesus says it this way. He says it in Matthew 6:24. "No one can serve two masters, for he will either hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Now, what's interesting is he doesn't say you can't serve God and the devil, right? He says you can't serve God, what is a good thing, and also serve money, which is a good thing that God has given us. You can't serve the Creator and the things that are created. Satan knows how to tempt us. And too many times we fall into the temptation where we are willing to serve the good things that God gives us, but we let them become our master. And what we have to realize is ultimately saved people serve God. And the reason we serve God is because God is worth serving. You know, I love the fact that while we are described as servants, Scripture also describes us as sons and daughters. So in Galatians 4:7, Paul puts it this way. He says, "So you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir through God." So we serve God, we are servants of God, but we don't serve God merely as slaves. We serve Him as sons and daughters. The difference is a servant serves out of obedience, but a son or a daughter serves out of an obedience based in love. The reason we serve the people that lead us well is because they love us well. And we all probably have relationships like that. You know, maybe it's a mother or a father, a grandparent, even teachers or coaches. We have people that are in authority over us. You know, they can tell us to do certain things, but we don't mind doing those things most of the time because we love them and we want to honor them. And so we honor them because of the love that they've shown us and the love we have for them through obedience. You know, I love the way that John Newton put this. Now, if you know anything about John Newton, maybe you know him as the author of the hymn Amazing Grace. He was a slave trader that turned pastor, and he described it this way. He said, "If two angels were to receive at the same moment a commission from God, one to go down and rule the earth's grandest empire, the other to go and sweep the streets of its meanest village, it would be a matter of entire indifference to each which service fell to his lot, the post of the ruler or the post of the scavenger. For the joy of the angels lies only in obedience to God's will." Oh, if that was true of our own lives. Too many times we want to serve God when it's convenient. But the mark of a true Christian that truly serves God as master is the one that serves God even when He calls us to do the things that we don't want to do, the things that are uncomfortable, the things that are awkward, the conversations that He calls us to have and we know it might get weird. Maybe He calls us to share the gospel with somebody. Maybe He calls us to go and befriend somebody that we don't know that well. He calls us to do hard things, but the joy in our life is not based on the thing we're asked to do. The joy in our life is based on the fact that we get to serve our Lord and our Savior. And so that all sounds good, but sometimes it can be a little squishy, a little fuzzy. You know what I mean? Like we all would like to say, yes, I want to serve God and kind of keep it vague. But as we continue to read this passage, we realize that there actually is a specific call placed on our lives when serving God. And so let's continue in verse 12. "When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, 'Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Now, it's interesting. I have a friend of mine, and years ago we were talking about this passage, and he was really confused because he thought about a couple of the times when Jesus said, "Do this thing," and we call them ordinances. You know, so baptism, we see Jesus get baptized and then we're called to follow his example in baptism. So it's something that we do in worship services time and again as we see new believers accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. Or the Lord's Supper, where we see Jesus with his disciples in the upper room, breaking bread with them, sharing the cup with them. And he says, "Do likewise." And so we do this time and again. And he said, it's weird that we don't do this foot washing thing. Like that should just be a thing that we do as a church. But you know, I think the reason that we don't gather on a regular basis as Christians and wash each other's feet is not just because it sounds kind of like weird and gross, but I think it's because foot washing is not just limited to actually cleaning someone's foot. Ultimately, what Jesus wants to remind us is that saved people serve people, that we need to be others focused. That foot washing is not just limited to this one act. See, the reason this was a big deal was because In ancient times, you know, they didn't have Nikes. They didn't have Vans. They didn't have baths and all that kind of thing. They didn't wear socks. And so when they'd walk in to a house, their feet would be filthy. And usually a servant would go wash their feet, clean them up so they didn't track dirt and all sorts of other disgusting things into the house. And what Jesus does is he takes the role of a servant. He stoops down to demonstrate to his disciples what it looks like to serve others. And ultimately, we realize he does this because he's motivated by love. He tells us this in verse 1 when he says, "Now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end." I just think about that picture of Jesus as he's on his way to the cross. He's on his way to sacrifice his own life for us. And as he is thinking about all that's going to happen to him, John records, it says, he loved them to the end. That when Jesus was on the cross, we were on his mind. What a beautiful reminder. What a great example that we have in Jesus who gave everything to serve us. And ultimately, I think that's what sets Christian ministry apart. You know, everybody can serve other people. Christians are not the only people that sacrifice for those that are in need. But there is a difference in what Christians do and what their motivation is. And I think it's really a really great example of this is in this story that I heard about this missionary to Africa who was asked if he really liked what he was doing. And you would think he'd kind of give the standard answer of, "I just love doing the thing that God called me to do." But that's not what he said. He said, "Do I like this work? No. My wife and I do not like dirt. We have recently refined sensibilities. We do not like crawling into vile huts through goat refuse. But is a man to do nothing for Christ he does not like? God pity him if not. Liking or disliking has nothing to do with it. We have orders to go, and we go. Love constrains us." The reason that we serve others is that we're motivated by love. We know the love that Jesus showed us and the sacrifice that he made for us. And so we want to extend that love to others. And there's a couple of ways that we're able to do this. Two ways that I think that we see in this passage how Jesus models how we are called to serve. First, we serve others by being intentional. Okay? We're not necessarily accidental servants. And I say this because if you think about Jesus' example, he intentionally does this whole thing where he takes off his outer garment, he grabs the towel, and he washes the feet of his disciples. He planned it out. He postured himself so that he could serve others. And we know this is a mark of his ministry because as Mark records in Mark 10:45, it says, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." He was intentional. He was focused. And I think we have to do the same. You know, we need to sign up for things. We need to tell people that we want to serve in certain areas. You know, we can do that in the church, whether it's signing up to lead a small group, to serve with the Learning Center. It could be serving, you know, when we gather back together on a Sunday morning, you know, helping as an usher or as a greeter. There's tons of opportunities in our student ministries where you can come and support and serve other people. You can reach out to your small group leader and say, "Hey, I want to be a servant in this small group. What can I do to be a leader among my peers?" And what you're doing is you're putting your feet down saying, "I am going to serve. I'm going to make plans to serve. I'm going to carve out time and energy to invest in the lives of other people." We have to be intentional. But I think the other thing we see is that we have to be available. Once again, we look at the example that Jesus gives, and he's doing this thing. He has this teachable moment where he's washing the disciples' feet, and Peter's giving him some pushback. And instead of just, you know, giving in to Peter or telling him just to sit down and be quiet and just let him do his thing, he takes that opportunity to serve Peter by teaching him, by helping him see the motivation behind what he's doing. And I think too often we can get so busy with our world, with our life, the things that we have to do, that we're just not available for opportunities to serve others. And what I hope we're able to do is to use the eyes that Christ gives us, to use the model that he's given us to say, "Hey, you know, when I wake up in the morning, pray a short prayer. God, help me see the opportunities that you give me today to serve people. We may not plan for them, we may not expect them, but they will be there. And the best thing we can do is to take advantage of those opportunities. Because ultimately, we serve others because of the example that Christ has shown us and the love that he's given us. He gave everything for us and calls us to sacrifice for the people that he places in our life because he loves us and he loves them. And I hope that we're able just to take some time and to think about and reflect on those real practical ways that we can be intentional to serve others, but also some ways that we can carve out some time in our own lives to be available for the opportunities that God gives us on a daily basis. Let's pray together. Lord, we just want to thank you once again for the picture that we have in Jesus who served us so well, the example that he gives us, but realizing, God, it's far more than an example, God, because his sacrifice bought our freedom. God, that we were slaves to sin, but because he served us and loved us to the end, God, we are free from the bondage of sin, and we are called to be members of your household. So God, I pray that you would encourage us to serve you well, but we would serve you as sons and daughters. God, we would give you our perfect obedience, not out of mere obligation, but ultimately because we are motivated by the love that you've shown us and the love that we have for you. We know we'll do this imperfectly, but we pray that you would continue just to work in us through your Spirit to more and more look more like Christ, who served us to the end and serves us still. We ask all these things in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen.